Hello and welcome to Aussie Tech Heads, episode 271, and it's the 5th of January. This is the first show of the new year, I think it might be. Happy New Year, everyone. Hope you had a great new year and everything went according to plan. You didn't lose any money, didn't lose any wallets or anything like that, but you might have found some. So good stuff, good stuff. Join us live every week, live.thesecrethub.com. We've been going every week for 5.5 years, Christmas, New Year's, Anzac Day, doesn't matter. We love it. We love it. We're there. We're always here for you every week, live.thesecrethub.com or on the iTunes, of course. Download the podcast. If you want to call into the show every week on Skype, the Skype call-in is Aussie Tech Heads, and audio only through the Shoutcast system, which I know we must have listeners because I got in trouble for not starting it up early tonight. So hello to the Shoutcast dudes. The videos are recorded and placed on YouTube at youtube.com/thesecrethub and also a paper each week, every day, in fact, twice a day, is paper.aussietechheads.com.au. And yeah, that's
just,
about
just
it.
Just beware, it's not actually a real paper.
No, that's right. It's a magazine online on the iPad, on the iPhone, on wherever you want to see it, on your video screen. And yes, you might have heard that little giggle, the little giggle and Gertie in the background.
Oh, yeah, thanks for that.
It's Will. He's back from the wilderness. And after we just have a quick chat to Will and we'll introduce Eric. Where's Will? Where are you, Will?
Where's Will?
Oh, I'm finally back in the land of living.
Oh, how you been doing? What's going on?
Yeah, sorry if there are any listeners of Talkback Tech and the Android show on here tonight as well. We've had delays because I have had a back injury, which basically hasn't allowed me to sit. I was pretty much in bed pretty much 90% of the day. So finally, good enough now, I can sit down and get back to it. And
good stuff.
And get practice because I'm finding it very difficult to actually put two words together.
All right, well, we're going to explore your back ailments further after we just say hello to Eric. Hello, Eric.
That's what she said.
Hello, sir. How do you do, gentlemen?
Hello, good, thank you. How's your week been?
My week has been all right so
good.
Far.
Good, better than last week.
What was last week like? I can't remember.
Yeah. No,
oh,
I can't either.
Last week with the dramas.
Yeah, I forget there what they were, but I just remember.
Oh, that's right. Move on. Half the glass is half full, so that's
yeah. All right. Now, what's been going on, Will? We'll further dissect your back injury. Now,
you had a particular type of treatment.
Yes. How was that?
Painful.
Yeah. Well, I had a sciatic injury, basically, and the sciatic nerve is a major nerve that runs, pretty much a full length of your body. There was a few options with treatment. There was standard physio. There was obviously, drugs and medication. There was acupuncture. There's a few different things. But a friend of mine had a treatment called Bowen therapy. And basically what Bowen therapy is, more or less, it's acupuncture without the needles. Mm. It's a nerve stimulation therapy.
Is it something actually, like Reiki or something like that?
Well, Reiki's different. Reiki realigns your chakras and things like that. Geez. It's a different thing again. But Bowen therapy or Bowen treatment is a lot of acupuncturists actually do it, and a lot of them actually prefer it. And it worked. The day after I had the treatment, all my nerves basically had a SPAC attack, which I was told they would, and I struggled to do anything.
Yeah.
And the following day, I was 150% on what I was a couple of days earlier. So, it obviously works. It's quite a weird thing. They basically lay down on a massage bench and she sort of just pokes, random points on your back and you're fixed.
Yeah, nice. Well, she must be poking in the right spot.
Yeah, that's great.
Did you get a number?
Yeah.
She charges me $70 for half an hour.
Oh, God, well, she's cheap.
At least you
get a look in.
At least you had a happy ending, so that's good.
That's right.
So, what else has been going on? Oh, that's about it, I suppose. Will's back on deck, so that's good to see.
Will, are you back on deck next week? Please say yes.
I hope so. I'm good. Certainly intending to be.
Good, because I won't be, because I just checked the time difference next week. And right now, it is midnight in where I'll be.
Oh, and what's your excuse? And?
Yeah, and?
And?
Well, that's it.
How long will you have been where you're going by that point?
I will. I would have been there 2 days.
Oh, so you're still on Australia time. Get over it.
Yeah, all right. So, yeah, well, that's all right. Yeah, midnight, that's a bit...
Unless you want to start it earlier.
No. Midnight's a bit harsh. No, it's all right.
So
it's
if you
right.
start at... it's 9 o'clock now. If you start at 7 Sydney time or 6 your time, that'd be 10 o'clock.
Yes.
10 p.m.
But it's... I can't... I can't do...
Hard work that'd be to start an hour earlier.
Yeah, I can't do it. Yeah, I can't do it because I got kids and stuff and they go crazy.
Oh, kids, don't worry about kids.
Now the excuses start.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I could just lock them in the cupboard, I suppose.
You could.
You've
done it before.
Anyway, so please, if you're watching on the video, please forgive my unkept look. I was.
Yeah, good. All right, Fatty Vorton. We'll do.
I had a few things happening today and just really pressed for time as it got towards showtime. And one of the things that I didn't get time to do was have a shave, so I apologise. But nevertheless, it's not affecting my speech so far.
not yet.
Not yet.
Only a bit.
Only a little bit. And what else did I have to say? It's probably affecting my mind rather than my speech. But it's a big news of the day. The big news of the day is the Doctor. Doxus 3.
Doctor.
He's in the house. Now, do you know what
it is? That's right.
Everyone here knows what Doxus 3 is, but Doxus 3 is Big Pond Ultimate. And I'm getting, now what I did a speed test today, and what did I get? Mm. I got a ping of 7 and down speed of 115, up speed of 2.4 meg. And that
yes, nice. it's the up speed that I was impressed with. The download speed is much as with the Optus Turbo, but the download is a good 750 higher, three quarters of a meg higher. It's amazing.
It's been going really well so far, so good anyway. And I think that this conversation is going rather exceptionally smooth as well. So it's good. It's working.
And the video is good too.
Yes.
Yeah. Gunner myself had a test Skype session early just to make sure everything's good. And Skype informed us that between his 2 meg connection and my 1.5 meg connection, it wasn't fast enough to enable widescreen.
There you go.
Who said that?
Skype.
Skype's an idiot.
Skype's, I won't use that word. But, so that's good. So they came and they installed and they left. And, yeah, straight away, first speed test. Like, I'm not sure why the thing thinks I'm in Adelaide, but, that's speedtest.net.
That's where it was set up. Glenn, it takes about a week and that resets itself and then you'll be on the Gold Coast.
Right. But that,
mine's in Sydney still. Mine's been in Sydney since I got it put in. So it just depends on where they're hosting it from, I suppose.
Yeah. But you're on Flop.
That happened to me. I was in Adelaide for a week.
Oh, okay.
Shit.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, that's right. I spent a month there one night. That's right.
good night, all Adelaide viewers.
Hello, Adelaide. Nice to meet you.
Yeah. See ya.
When Eric says Adelaide, he means the other Adelaide.
That's right. Yeah. I mean the other Adelaide, the serial killer capital of the world.
No, it's the same one.
Yeah. So the Doxus 3 is good. So far, so good. It's 2.4 up. I can't be happier. And as I think the rumor who's sulking around there in the lounge somewhere, he told me on the Facebook, welcome to the congestion. So hopefully I don't get any of that. Eric, you haven't seen any congestion to note?
Nothing. Yeah. It might drop down a bit. You know, during the school holidays, it drops down, in the peak busy times in the afternoon.
Yeah,
when they're all the kids are back from their beach trips or whatever, and it might drop down to, I don't know, 70, 60.
Right. Oh, no.
You know?
But I think because the up speed is still the same.
I might ring up
and complain. Yes. But, look, I had a bit of a chat to the guys that installed it because, I'm thinking of this congestion and I'm thinking of the loop and all this sort of stuff. And I said, how many have you installed today? And he goes, and they've been doing like 10 a day. 10 and that's just around...
And that's just one, subby, that's right.
Yes, and that's just around Robina, just around here. And I said, okay, are people changing from ADSL to Big Pond or to the cable? And he said, no, these are just new installs. So, Yeah, it's crazy. And the other bad news I had today, well, I had bad news. Not I didn't have any other. This was the bad news. I rang up my ADSL provider on the net. Can't believe it. They've been good to me for all this time until you want to part. And but yes, it's in their terms and conditions because my month finishes tomorrow. So I thought, yes, I'm going to ring up. I'm going to cancel this. And I won't have to pay another month because it finishes tomorrow. I'm on fire. Yes, well, just worked out perfect. And so anyway, I rang them up and they said, well, it takes 5 days. You've got to give us 5 days notice. And I said, so what does that mean? She goes, we're going to have to pay another month. So I went, right.
Name and shame.
Yeah, but it is in their terms and conditions. So I suppose I can't.
So what?
Yeah, what do you mean?
Doesn't matter. But goodwill. It's a goodwill gesture.
But I'm leaving.
Look what Telstra did for me.
Yeah, but
when I cancelled my day ADSL, mid-contract.
But you already had another connection with them.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
So that's a bit different. You're not going to the opposition, are you?
Well, not really, no.
Yeah,
but still. the cancellation fee of $268, they can.
Mm. Yeah.
And then my contract had run, I think, 5 or 10 days over the start date, and I got a credit for $60.
Yeah, that's all right.
Yeah, actually, Optus credited me $75 on my first bill.
There you go.
Because when they first put it in, they forgot to enable the high speed.
Oh,
yep,
yeah. Yeah.
And because I had a few problems with the splitter and stuff out the front. So they basically gave me half my first bill back and cancelled the modem fee and something else I was supposed to charge me. So,
Yeah. So
it's a goodwill gesture. Goodwill gesture.
Yeah. Well, they're not going to give me any goodwill because I'm ditching them. But yeah, I don't know.
But you're never going to come back now, are you?
Well, good probably not.
This.
Yeah,
it's long term. They've got to think long term, these people. You think, well, you know what? If he comes back, we'll treat him nicely. And he might tell his friends that how good the service was instead of getting slagged off on his show like he is now.
Well, I was. I did have cable and I did go to ADSL because at that time they did offer a higher up speed because that's when Telstra was capped at, I think I was capped at 128 or something.
Mm. Yeah, 128 or 512 or something.
Yeah, and it was a joke. And so I went to the ADSL where I got at least 0.9 up, so that was all right. But but now I'm back to cable and loving it.
Good stuff.
All right. So let's move on to some stories, I guess. We got all the chit chat out of the way. Before I do that as well, just for those on the video, because those on the audio podcast won't give a toss. But I've got another little camera here, and you can have a look. This is the camera that. Sees what I see, if you know what I mean. That's the shot. So I'll flick to that every now and then, and you can see how it's all going. All right.
He'll flick to that one when he's typing in his username and password, so just take note of what side it is.
Yeah, well, I've got another one down here for that. See that? But my fingers move so fast, it's just a blur.
No, that's not your fingers. That's the bad frame rate of the epoxy camera.
Don't. Being caught out again. All right. So let's start off with a story then. Does anyone want to start or do you want me to start? I'll start.
Oh, I'm a bit rusty, so I should make a fool of myself first, shouldn't I?
Okay.
Yeah, why not?
You start.
All right. Let's do this. I was actually reading somebody posted it to my Facebook wall and I don't know who they were, but there's a link to an article on someone had a slight issue with PayPal. And now over the Christmas break, there was a big drama with them not taking out money when they're supposed to and not honouring gift vouchers and stuff like that. But apparently there's a lady who was selling a antique violin on eBay and a supposed collector paid $2,500 and got it. And it was a World War II violin. You know, it had been authenticated. It was legitimate. And the buyer, who for whatever reason decided that he wanted his money back, and so instead of just returning it and saying, hey, you know, give us a refund, he looked through the terms and conditions in eBay and PayPal, and PayPal deemed the violin counterfeit, even though there's no such thing in the violin world. And the buyer was so proud that he sent a photo back to the seller of the destroyed violin, and they PayPal pulled the $2,500 out of her account and paid him back.
Oh, no way.
And there's actually a thing in the terms and conditions in PayPal that says, it says PayPal may also require you to destroy the item and to provide evidence of its destruction.
Oh, right. Yes. No way.
So not only does this lady lose $2,500, she loses the potential to sell it to somebody else who could buy it, and she loses the item. So she's basically effectively, out of pocket.
$2,500+. Yeah, that's crazy. That's crazy because I know because I got some software that was counterfeit from off a site, Quick Sales or whatever it is in Australia, and I know come from China. And they said, well, if you want the refund, you've got to send it back or something. And I'm thinking, well, I'm not going to send it back. It's going to cost me more to send it back than what the stupid thing's probably worth. Mm. So I just decided to keep it. And that's
the thing. Normally, the counterfeit policy is in place for things like software and fake Rolexes. They don't want the buyer to take the item back and resell it to someone else. So theory is you destroy it, or you take a photo of a destroyed item that looks like it, you send that to PayPal, and you get your money back.
Yeah, right.
But it's not designed for this sort of thing.
No, it's hard because, do you think that the violin was actually a fake, or was it because
it was legitimate. It had a certificate of authenticity.
I think the buyer, according to this article, the buyer questioned the authenticity label and complained to PayPal or eBay, whoever it was. And
PayPal,
they said, and I don't know what their process was. It's like you saying,
well, they didn't have one.
But I don't know how they came to the decision that says just because someone complained, well, it must be a counterfeit. Someone complained.
That's not good.
So I don't know what their process was to then tell the buyer to say, I'll just destroy it and we'll give you your money back.
That's fairly
rash.
Another downside to the PayPal, isn't it? Is because where do you go to complain? It's one of these faceless organisations.
Well, the seller now is thinking, that was a legitimate violin.
Yeah, now he's down the violin also, and the $2,500.
I've actually kind of shot myself in the foot because I've actually completely lost the link to the article, but it's on my Facebook page and on my Twitter at Mr. Tompkinson. You can find the link there. But it actually,
I'll post it on the chat, Will, on the Google chat, on the window here. There it is. Huffington Post, there you go.
Yeah, because if you actually go to the article and read the comments, they'll say, there's a guy on there who paid $2,500 for what they call a Stradivarius replica, which basically means it's built on the design of the Stradivarius. Yeah. So he paid $2,500 for a replica violin. So he's saying, even if it was a fake, it's still worth the $2,500 that they distributed.
Crazy.
Disputed over.
That's insane. That's insane. But that's crazy. But anyway, I've got a story. Now, there's this site I come across through the week. It's to tell you if you've been naughty and been downloading BitTorrents.
Oh, yeah.
So what happens is, it's rubbish. It doesn't work because obviously most of the people, well, in Australia anyway, we're on dynamic IPs. So, this site doesn't really work. Mm. But anyway, it's a crawler designed by the owners, and it's at the site of, what's the name of the site here? Oh, I did have it here. Here, look, have a look at a picture while I try and find this site.
There was a couple of them. And as you say, it works if you've got static IP, but...
Yeah, it's the site's called, I don't have the URL, but the site's called youhavedownloaded.com, is it? Let me just type that in and see if it's you have... Jeez, that's probably one of the things I meant to do today as well. I think I do remember now, is to get that link. So downloaded.
Is that a Windows program?
No, it's a web thing.
It's a Java app, I think.
There we go. We have no records on me. Well, there you go. Oh, well, I've only just changed over. Yeah.
That's right.
Yep. But it did have a record. It did have a record yesterday when I was on the ADSL, but it came up with it was something that I hadn't downloaded. So it's obviously because...
Yeah, you have downloaded.com.
They're only going off... They're monitoring basically packets, and they're going off packet matches.
Yeah, so that's so rubbish, but it's a bit of fun. Best, but, yeah,
they get it. On mine, it was probably about maybe 50-50.
Yeah, 50-50, okay.
Probably closer to 60-40, you know, wrong, right.
Right.
So,
yeah.
But it wasn't too bad.
So the developers are saying that they're not in the business of trying to catch out the pirates. They just wanted to demonstrate that such a crawler is possible. Yes, that's just they just wanted a demonstration. I don't know why. Maybe they're trying to sell this thing to someone. But as I said, static, probably, dynamic. Yeah. But it's
well,
not
going to the government all the time. You know, that's what Google does. That's how their analytics are so spot on. You know,
but you have downloaded.com had to point out that there were some instances where IP addresses belonging to government copyright enforcement agencies are listed having downloaded files. Torrent Freak has so far shown IP addresses belonging to the Recording Industry Association of America, the US House of Representatives, and the Canadian and French governments that would appear to have connected to the BitTorrent download and download.
Oh, well, that could be because they're analyzing, you know, it could be for their own purposes to see.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
What sort of quality that the pirating is doing and
yes.
all that.
Yes,
so,
that's right.
Involved.
That's right. But
well,
you know,
I've just gone on there. It's just we have no records on you.
Right, yeah. Yeah, no, I had...
I don't torrent.
Yeah, I had one record on my IP at the time, and that wasn't something I did, so...
Kim?
Yeah, that's right. All right, now, look, I saw this through the week. I don't know if it's any... interest or whatever, but look, this Sharp TV, like I didn't know how big TVs actually got around this place, but Sharp have got a few TVs out now. They got this 70 inch. Now, as you can see in that graphic there, the 70 inch stand,
that's massive.
Yeah, up to a lady's shoulder, and who knows how big this lady is, but it's up to her shoulder, and she might be a dwarf.
She's pretty big, dude,
as
now,
in tall.
That's, I'm assuming, a LCD or an LED.
Sharp has
a CRT. Look at the size of the bloody back.
No, but that's in a frame. They're frames. The TV's in a frame in this picture. That's not the actual thickness of the TV.
Well, it looks like shit.
Well, I was just demonstrating the size.
On the story you've got there, I can't find... Oh, there we go. Full LCD panel.
Yeah, so it's 70 inch. It's like 70 inches. It's massive. They've tagged it the ultimate in big screen home entertainment. What's it got? It's got all these colours. Delivers fast processing, so you never see any lag, sharp pictures and distinct colours. It has a full array of LCD panel that includes Sharp's Quattro 4-pixel technology. Blah, blah, blah. It has a 100 hertz panel. It's DLNA compatible, USB media playback, YouTube and a web browser function, so it can be connected to your home network. It has HD...
That's smart TV.
4 HDMI ports.
42 kilos, dude.
Yeah,
42.5 kgs, and it's lighter than the 60-inch Panasonic plasma. What is that?
Well,
65-inch LCD.
We just bought a 51-inch Samsung. Well, just when we moved in, and it's a plasma, and it would be close on 50-odd kilos, if not more, probably 65.
That's huge.
Yeah, that's isn't it?
Huge.
That is.
I mean, 50 inches massive. You know,
I don't know.
You know, our lounge room's 5 meters long, and 50-inch in there is huge. So, I mean, unless you had a...
Yeah. Why wouldn't you have a...
media room, I guess.
Why wouldn't you just have a projector?
Well,
because
I mean,
the bulbs are expensive to bloody replace.
Well...
Yeah. I saw a projector in some magazine the other day for like $300. Are they like that cheap
it
now?
It depends. I mean, if you can use a cheaper projector...
Get one for the
...to
toilet.
Do a 100-inch picture quite happily...
Yeah.
And the bulbs aren't that much, but if you're going any bigger than that, you need to step it up, and then yes, they do get expensive.
Mm.
Yeah, it's about $800-$900 per bulb.
Mm. Yeah, and $3,000 for the projector.
$4,799.
Well, speaking of TVs,
yes,
there's a rumor that Apple is developing a TV. This was a story in today's news.com.au. They're saying that it's going to be. Someone that used to work there has obviously opened their mouth and said that he saw a slick 50-inch TV inside the lockdown studio of Sir Jonathan Ive, because he's now a knight of the realm.
Yep. Yes.
Former Apple employees. Sorry, go on.
I was just going to say, when people have been... Look, I hadn't realised this, but when people were talking about Apple TV, I didn't actually think of it as a TV.
Yes, well, see, that's the confusion, because their little dongle, their little puck device, they call an Apple TV.
Yeah, the little puck. That's right.
The little puck, the little hockey puck. So, yeah, so it's dubbed to be called ITV, which is another silly name.
Mm.
But it's going to range from 42 to 50 inch.
Yeah.
And it will run the...
They're LED, I think, that they would be, knowing Apple. That'd be.
I would say that it would be LED if maybe... Well, it won't be OLED because it'll price it out. But, yeah, definitely LED.
But it's a... Yeah, it's actual TV. I wasn't aware that that's what they were. But, yeah, it's an actual TV.
There you go.
So there you go.
So as opposed it'll to run just... the operating system, bring the App Store to the living room, use the Apple's AirPlay, etc., etc.
I think this actually. I'll show you a picture. Oh no, that's still a TV connected to the dongle puck thing.
I don't think. I think if they do release an actual TV, it will be standalone. It won't have the. It won't have.
Yeah.
Anything else?
That's what I mean. Yeah.
I'm thinking that they'll have the current puck integrated into this ITV.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, possibly. Yeah. I mean, you could put a Mac Mini inside the back of it, really, realistically.
Oh, you could.
And use Bluetooth Bluetooth mouse and keyboard.
Yeah. I've got a funny feeling Apple won't go the keyboard route because they want it to be simple.
Well, that touchpaddy thing that they use.
Yeah, or you'll just run it via your iPad or your phone. You'll control it by your phone.
Mm.
Well, that works too. I mean,
if they really want to sell a lot of these... If they want to sell a lot of these TVs, what they should do is make that app available to all smartphones and not just the iPhone. Because you imagine how many people go, if you've got an Android phone or a Windows 7 phone and you've got an Apple remote app that you can download and control the Apple TV, everyone would buy it.
Mm.
You know how there was a statistic a few months ago saying that there was on average something like 150,000 Android devices activated daily? I don't know if you guys covered this, but on Christmas Day, that went up to like, I think it was 2.5 million or something like that in one day.
No, it was, what was it? It was, we covered this last week. It was over the Christmas break, from the 25th to the 29th, 7 million iOS and Android devices were activated.
Yeah, it's insane. Yeah.
But 6. Just 8. In one day, there was, you know, like 2.5 million Android devices. And that's the thing, like, people have got to realize, regardless of whether it's Apple or third-party developers, you can't just develop for... Well, you can. You can just develop for the iPhone, but you shouldn't.
No.
Apple are not going to change anytime soon.
No, Apple aren't. But, you know, like...
Well, it really took them a long time. It took them a long time to make iTunes available for Windows. They refused to for a long time. Steve Jobs refused to.
It sucked.
Yeah, it still does. But the point is, it got Windows users buying iPods.
Yes.
No, it didn't.
Yes, it did. Well, I think heaps of them. The market opened right up.
Yeah.
I think it's the other way around. I think people
now have an iPod.
It's the other way around. People bought iPods. Well, people use iTunes because they bought an iPod. They didn't necessarily know that they needed iTunes at the time. So I don't think it was...
No, but yeah. Well, I get that. That's true. Initially, that is the case. But then a lot of Windows users were going, oh, well, shit, there's no point me buying an iPod because I can't use it on iTunes. And then as soon as iTunes was available, they went, oh, you beaut, I can now buy an iPod. And their iPod sales went through the roof.
And they went, oh, why on earth did I do that? Mm. I can't use my computer anymore.
Yeah,
it's not that bad. I know it sucks, but it's not that bad.
No, it's all right. It's good. But anyway, speaking of who are we talking about? Jono. Sir,
I don't know.
Sir Jono.
Sir Jonathan Ive.
Jonathan Ives, he's been knighted. He's obviously a British citizen. Or not
subject.
Is that a subject. Does that mean he's a citizen?
He's British-born. I'm not sure if he's a US citizen, but he's definitely got a green card.
He's a British citizen. The British monarch has awarded a knighthood to Jonathan Paul Ive, a British citizen and head of Apple's design team since the mid-90s. He received the Order of the British Empire for services to design and enterprise. His credits, obviously, include he's the whimsical and colourful designs of the iMac computers in the 1990s, which came in
1997.
Which came in, remember, those bright colours and bland shades and all that sort of stuff. And his later designs, obviously, and of course, the iPod, the iPhone, and the iPad. And this is not the only time the Queen's had him in her sights. He's also been recognised in the honours list. In 2005, he was made a commander of the British Empire, a CBE. So there you go.
Well, there you go. Good for you, Johnny.
That's right.
Well, CBE, my four-wheel drive. Didn't think it was that important.
Yeah.
No, do you wear it around your neck?
I might as well. It's about as useful at the moment.
Can you pin it to your chest?
It went swimming. It hasn't worked since.
Now, Optus. They're going crazy. Well, not really. I think this is all a bit of a blow up, you know,
It is a blow up, but it is funny.
Yeah.
Their systems haven't been adjusted.
Oh, it's an error. I don't think it's even a matter of being adjusted. It's an error. And what we're talking about is there's a glitch on the Optus Rewards website, which is causing outrage and caused outrage amongst women because they couldn't sign up to the rewards site. If you were a doctor, if you're a girl and you're a doctor, the site said, please use, what did it say? It goes,
please select a title and the title should match
your gender. Yes.
So in other words, if you're a doctor, well, you can't be a woman.
Because you got male and female down further. Okay.
Yep. This issue is not, the Optus come out and said this issue is not gender specific. It has caused, they apologize for any inconvenience it has caused. This was not our intention, obviously. Obviously, we are working.
Obviously, it's not their intention. That's just lazy coding. That's all.
It's probably not even that. It'd be a generic template that 45 million websites use. I mean, I can guarantee you, there's millions of others out there that'll have the same problem.
Yeah, and as far as the story went, which you know, you can't tell if it's true or not because I think the problem's been fixed. But it was it happened to males as well. It's just there was a problem with the doctor title. That was it.
You sure the male wasn't a transgender?
Not
you either.
Well, that's discriminatory, isn't it? Because I've never seen a third box on any of these.
So, isn't that right? Isn't that what Ms. is?
No, Ms.
Like MR. No, I saw it somewhere. It was MRZ. I think it was just a typo on their forum. It's supposed to be MRS.
Yes.
But it was MRZ.
MRZ.
Well, goodness. They should have another box here. So it should be transgender and pre-op.
Well, just pre and post.
Yeah, pre and post. Pre and post female and pre and post male.
Yeah, that's all. That's all.
Then you've got all bases covered.
Oh, too much of that going on.
Then you can click the right box.
Well, yeah, that's right. Well, I think we better talk Audible. We're halfway through the show. Now, I think, Eric, you've been diligent and listening to Audible through the week.
Yes, I have. And did you get my grab?
Or was it a grab?
Yeah, put it in your player.
Oh, it is too. It's a WMV. Sorry, I thought they were all pictures.
Put it in your player and the graphics there and everything with the sound grab.
All right, hang on. Whoops. Now, what have we got here? Tonight, we've got, or this week, have you listened to this or you started listening to this?
I reviewed it.
Right, okay. All right, so I'll play the grab. And we can have a listen and see what it's all about.
Like my best closing arguments, my eulogy.
We might
short,
even start that from the start. How's that? Hang on, we'll take that back and we'll start it from the start. Might be better. So this is a conflict of interest.
Yes, by Adam Mitzner, narrated by David Ledoux.
David Ledoux. Okay, now here we go. We'll get the where's Eric's Audible. I've got
put it on the stream.
Did I get?
Because graphics there.
I'm looking for graphics. Hang on. I know I downloaded them, didn't I? Graphics. Where'd the graphics go? I don't know.
It's WMV.
I've got the audio.
I recorded it from on VidBlaster, so the graphics are all across there.
Oh right. Oh okay. Right. So they're not separate.
No, it's on there.
No,
oh, the graphic. Just put it in your play and press play. Put it to the stream, and the graphics will come up.
All right, I can do that. I have the technology. Hang on a sec.
We have the technology.
I wasn't ready for one of these. Jeez, da-da. So now I've got to do another window and do things
no,
like
just
that.
Just add media player to VidBlaster.
Oh, I've done that. I don't have to do that. I've done that. Here we go.
Like my best closing arguments, my eulogy is short. As I think all eulogies should be, especially when delivered in the hot Florida sun to people past retirement age. I can sometimes spend a week crafting a presentation to a jury, but I didn't put pen to paper about my father until last night. The words came to me easily, however, a sign that I'd been composing my father's legacy, at least as seen through my eyes, for years. As I knew she would, my mother smiles approvingly when I mention that my father was a man who had few close friends, and that while she had tried several times to get him to befriend the husbands of her friends, it was usually without success. I remember one time, I tell the 30 or so mourners gathered in front of the gravesite, my mother said he must be one of those unique individuals who didn't need anyone else. A complete unit unto himself was the phrase she used. My dad was not a man prone to displays of affection, but his eyes got moist and he wrapped both hands around hers. Very softly, as if he didn't even want me to hear, he told her that it wasn't that he didn't need anyone, he just didn't need anyone but her. My father died 3 days ago.
There we go.
Done. Yeah, so this is about Alex Miller, a criminal defense lawyer. And at 35, he's the youngest partner at a New York City law firm.
Right.
And his father passes away. He's introduced to a gentleman called Michael Olig, a powerful man who holds a mythical place in his family's history. But Mr. Olig admits that he's in serious trouble. And throughout the course of two trials, secrets are revealed that force Alex Miller to question whether any of the people in his life are who they appear to be.
Interesting. That sounds good. So, Eric, you've got a bit of a knack of picking good ones, because every week they're interesting and makes me want to, if I had the money, yes, I'd go out and listen to them all. But
if I had the time, I'd go out and listen to them. Probably time first,
and then the rest. But yes. If you want a free credit from the Audible, and maybe download half that book, or put it towards that book, you can go to the AussieTechHeads.com.au website, click on the link and sign up. And if you sign up through via that link, you help us as well as helping Audible. But you don't have to sign up, continue subscription. You just get in, get your free one, keep it forever, and away you go. And I know you guys are signing up because I've been getting feedback from Audible, so thank you very much. And keep it up. And you know who you guys are that have clicked and signed up through the link. And I thank you. Thank you very much. It's very, very nice. Okay. All right. So
where's my commission?
Yeah, it's in the post.
Checks in the mail.
It's the postage stamp that's coming.
That's right. Got to mail a stamp. Well done. Speaking of people failing to meet their targets, you want to talk about the NBN?
Oh, look, I have got an NBN story.
I think you've got the same story as myself.
Oh, yeah, go. Which one have you got?
Read yours, because that was the release that NBN put out in the quiet period, hoping that no one would notice.
Right.
And they obviously tried to spin it a little bit.
So have you got the price hike? Is this the one?
I've got the contrarian analysis.
This is the price hike one?
No, not the price hike one. This is about... this is about how many people have got on there. Yes.
Okay. Well, I'll get the right graphic up. There we go. Okay. Now over. Can you believe it? Over. Only 4,000 people.
Didn't they try and spin it? They tried to spin it in a positive way.
Yep. I think now from memory, which wasn't in this story, and you might be able to shed some light on this, Eric, but I thought I heard, I think it was on the radio broadcast somewhere, that although they've got 4,000 people connected, I think their plan was 32,000. 35,000 by this this stage.
35,000 by June 2011.
So they've stuffed that up, haven't they?
137,000 by June 2012, which is 6 months away. Now, let it be known that I'm not against the NBN. I've always said that. I think it's a good thing.
Hmm.
Not that Glenn and I need it now.
No. I'd still like 40 up, though. I'd still like
40 up. That's right. So I'm not against the NBN. And the fact that Telstra will get migrated straight across, and Glenn and I and Will as well will get pretty much bootstrapped straight into it when it comes operational. I'm not against it. I am against the complete balls up of a management of this system.
It is insane.
It is absolutely insane.
So what we've got here.
Honestly, did anybody expect anything else?
No, we didn't. We all had our fingers crossed that it wouldn't get any worse, but...
But also, yeah, but like it's been, actually, so the story goes, the NBN's pleased with the connection numbers. Now, 4,000 has been rolled past 18,200 homes and businesses and premises.
Why haven't they taken them up? Why is 4,000 over 18,000 is less than what? 10% is, you know, it's just under, just 20% of households.
Households
that they've had rolled over.
Yeah, no, but it's not good.
They're supposed to have 35,000 customers.
Now, that their reasoning for the connection being small
in
comparison to the activations is a spokeswoman said this was because a number of internet service providers have still yet to bring their plans to market.
Liar.
Yeah. Because
they've all got their plans out there.
Yeah, if you wanted it, you'd be...
You can get it.
Yeah, why would... Who's doing it? iiNet and all this sort of stuff?
Let's put it this way. I mean, a lot of internet providers, but let's put it this way. The small ones may not have, but they have such a small footprint in this market. iiNet have got their plans out there.
Yeah.
Internode have got their plans out there. All the big guys have got their plans out there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, they're not... I mean, when was the last time you saw an ad for it? You don't. And that's the thing.
They're not actively marketing it, that's for sure.
No, and that's the thing. You know, geeks, techs, whatever you want to call us, tend to forget that the average person has no clue. I know for a fact my sisters don't know anything about the NBN. You know, only what I tell them, you know, and that's the thing. The reason the take-up is
right.
So
poor,
you're
absolutely right.
It's because nobody actually actively goes out there and sells a product.
Yeah.
And whatever that's happening, it's going to stay like that.
You are absolutely right. We live in a bubble and we keep up to date on these things. So to us, it seems like an absolute, you know, this is a joke, which it is a joke.
It is. There's no doubt.
But you're right. The people who do have these, the big guys, iiNet, etc. I haven't seen one ad from iiNet. Even if it was a targeted ad, newspaper ad in those regional areas would be better than nothing.
I've seen one ad and I think it was a government ad. On the NBN.
Yeah, that would have been well made too.
Yeah, it was fantastic.
Yeah, well, can you imagine?
The head of the NBN head of industry relations, Mr. Jim Hassell, he has come out and he says a crucial task for 2012 will be to educate and inform Australians about the principles that dictate the rollout. So there you go.
Yeah. Forget that. Just start selling the freaking thing. That's you know what that means? More spin.
The NBN
that's what that is.
The NBN is due to be extended to another 500,000 premises in 2012, and the project is expected to be completed by 2021.
Yeah, right. This is not going to be finished till 2030.
Yeah.
Either at this pace. Yeah. Put it this way. They were supposed to have 35,000 by June 2011, but they only had 18,000 premises. So how can you have 35,000 premises hooked up on 18,000 premises?
Yeah. But if you look at that graphic that I've flashed up on the screeny, it doesn't look like the NBN is not going to get started until 2014.
Yeah. At least.
That's why I'm saying. Go on. Sorry, Will.
I was going to say, they've made it so hard on themselves. I mean, no disrespect to Tasmania, but if you're rolling out a major infrastructure modification and redesign, why wouldn't you do it in the middle of the cities where one city could potentially get you X amount of millions?
You'd get 35,000 in Brisbane, Sydney, Perth and Melbourne in the first week.
Yeah,
exactly.
And then you've got the hype that goes along with it.
It's designed to fail. It really is. It's designed to say, look how much money we've thrown at this over the last 10 years, and we've got 35,000 users. Let's scrap it, shall we? And all that infrastructure that's there, it'll go dead, and it'll be like dark fiber in the US, take somebody like Google to start buying it and selling it to do anything with.
You put that very well. It's designed to fail because of their ineptitude. You're exactly right. Now, this is Malcolm Turnbull's response. Now, let it be known that I think he takes a far too negative view, even though I am a supporter of Liberal Party. I think he does take a too far a negative view of this, but he does have some valid points. According to the NBNs, we all talked about the 35,000, blah, 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 blah. Today's announcement that only 4,000 households are connected to NBN fibre, despite more than $1 billion already ploughed into this vastly expensive project, yet again confirms Labor's inability to manage money or execute policy. Well, tick, correct. Not lying there.
Mm.
the Rudd and Gillard governments have been in office for 4 years. Tick. No lie about that. In that time, they have managed to improve broadband for only 4,000 Australian households. Tick. Now, blah, blah, blah. The rest of it's, you know, he's just, I'm not going to read it. He just goes off. But I did some maths.
Yeah.
At 4,000 people and $1 billion spent, that's an average of $250,000 per connection that they've spent.
How much?
Right. $250,000 per connection.
Whew.
Right.
But is this now, infrastructure that's going in, is that backbone infrastructure that's needed anyway?
Everything. You can call it all you like.
I mean, how? It's not like it costs that much money to pull a cable through a conduit. They're not redesigning the power poles. They're not redesigning the holes in the ground.
They're just laying cable.
They're just literally laying fiber optic cable. That's all right. They're doing. I mean, it's okay.
Bureaucracy, built, Will.
Yeah. A lot of that's probably the head end of the exchanges and things like that. Other than that, that's the other thing. I don't understand why it's taking so long, because it does not take that long to roll out cable.
Oh, look.
Foxtel rolled out cable, I think, in 2 years, Will?
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. To all the
Optus,
major areas.
What about Optus? Optus did the same thing. When they were allowed to compete, to come into the market and compete, they laid their cable out in no time at all.
Mm.
Exactly. They had it out in a couple of years to all the major areas, and then another couple of years to the outlying areas.
Look,
that's right.
I lay cable every morning. It doesn't take that long. But right. The NBN...
5 minutes in a magazine, you're done.
That's right.
Look at the speed.
Oh, that's right. Oh, no splashback.
What's your download speed, Glennie?
Oh, it's gravity. Now,
hang on. Let's just do this.
300 feet per second per second.
That's right. 250. So that's an average that they've spent of 250,000 per connection.
Yeah.
Now,
if
each customer picked one of their expensive plans, it's $100 per month.
Right.
Right? So if each customer, at $100 per month per customer, the payback period, in other words, when the NBN would get their money back on these 4,000 customers, is 2,500 years.
Oh, jeez.
That's not too bad. I mean, you know, unless you get a return.
The stun will be...
The Daleks would have eaten us by then.
The Daleks. But the NBN's going to spend more money. They haven't finished yet, Eric.
They haven't finished. They've barely started.
They're spending more.
A drop in the bucket for this Labor government.
The NBN is forced to charge high prices if they do not give Optus $800 million to shut down their cable network.
But that's already been agreed. They've already agreed to give them $850 million. So I don't know what they're bitching about.
But because why? See, this is the other thing I don't understand. Why shut existing infrastructure? Why not use it as a massive
redundancy? Would have redundancy built in.
And combine it in one giant daisy chain and use all the available bandwidth.
Well, so what's happening is it's before the arbitrator.
Because you know why, Will, that'd cost another $5 billion.
So the decision for this $800 million is in front of the arbitrator. So Telstra's, the NBN is saying...
How is that possible? I thought they already agreed to this.
Well, apparently it's
they did.
Well, they might have agreed, but apparently this I don't know, whoever it is, anti-competition dude or whatever, he's having a look at it, and they've put their arguments up to him, and then NBN has said, well, we want the Optus cable, and Optus says, well, we want $800 million, and so they're saying without the deal, Optus would be able to, so without the deal, okay, so there's no $800 million, they don't buy Optus out. Without buying Optus out, Optus would be able to cherry pick the best customers to offer them broadband on the cable, right? And at the moment, passing 2.4 million premises in affluent areas and fast growth in corridors in Brisbane, Melbourne, and Sydney. So, thereby, potentially inhibiting.
Doesn't make any sense.
It doesn't make any sense at all.
Hang on, I haven't finished.
Especially given that, how can you buy Optus cable when you're only providing internet? Now, Optus Cable provides television as well as internet. So are they just going to buy the internet half of Optus's cables? Yeah.
Yes. Well, I know. As hard, as physically impossible as that is to split, yes.
So what the whole idea is...
They're just going to buy 1,000 to 1,500 megahertz frequency and leave the rest for the TV.
Yeah, there'll be no balls up there.
But no, they're not going to buy it. They'll just stop Optus from doing it. So at the end of the day, and to round off, why why they're buying Optus from NBN's point of view is therefore okay. So it's gonna they don't want Optus to cherry pick. If they did, they would be potentially inhibiting the NBN company's ability to cross subsidise to deliver lower uniform national prices.
Oh bollocks!
Oh, look, that's just their excuse. That you know, this is a bargaining chip that they've already agreed to Optus to pay $850 million. NBN are now going, oh shit, we've blown $1 billion. Let's see if we can lower what we're paying Optus, and let's put out something that makes it look like, well, Optus are stalling, and if they don't come to the party, NBN's going to go up. This is all bullshit. This is all NBN backpedaling because they know that they spent too much money.
Wouldn't it be in their best interest to say, hey, Optus, why don't you just become a reseller the same as everybody else and you can compete, you know, the same as it works now? Telstra does, for an example, okay, Foxtel and Optus TV. Or, yeah, what's it called? What used to be Austar. You know, one, Austar was rural. It provided the services that the cabled, the hardwired Foxtel couldn't provide. So why not do the same thing and say, well, look, you're going to be a reseller, I don't know, in Ipswich because Telstra's got Brisbane.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I don't know their reasoning. I think that they want Telstra and Optus pits to be transferred across and their cable decommissioned. And this is what the Liberal governments have been saying all along, because they want a monopoly.
Well, they want the monopoly.
Exactly right, they do.
They want the monopoly so the bush won't... Because at the moment, the bush doesn't get fast speeds and it gets expensive speeds. So that's why they want to, as I said, uniformly...
Well, that I understand. That's fine. Do that. Why don't they say, okay, Optus, you are responsible for the bush, less like Austar was for TV.
But they won't want to be responsible for the bush because there's no money out there. Without the... Well, without that's the,
true.
Without,
there is. Especially, I mean,
but not without the
now,
subsidy of the
city. I've got friends
who
are
cities
out of town, and their only internet option, according to federal guidelines, is satellite, which is slow and painful and incredibly expensive.
Massively expensive.
I can go there. I mean, okay, they get the rebates for the install and stuff like that, but they don't. They still have to pay. They're paying $150 a month for 200 meg of data.
200 meg. Wow.
Yeah.
So the thing is, I went out there the other day with my Telstra phone and I got full high speed on my phone. Yeah. So
well, that's what a lot of farmers are doing. They're actually getting 3G smartphones or dongles and, you know, paying $70 a month to get 12 gigs and, Bob's your uncle.
And that's my point. Like, the farmers are willing to pay if you give them an option.
Yeah.
But still,
because it's all a tax deduction for them anyway.
Yeah.
Well, you know what it could be? It could be the fact that they don't want to service them with proper internet because they're making too much. They're making too much, so much cream from the satellite service.
Well,
why would you kill the golden goose?
Yeah.
That's true.
Look,
that's what I think it is. It's all profit motive.
I can see where the NBN is coming from, but I think they still.
Yeah, but again, it's the implementation.
Yeah. I think they should have chucked in.
If you go back 18 months, whenever we first started talking about the ABN, to the first episode that we talked about at Aussie Tech Heads, I said, as soon as the government has anything to do with this, it will be dead.
Yeah.
We all agreed to that.
Yeah.
We all said the same thing, and it's right.
And that was before the government got involved.
We said this when they announced it in 2007, and just before they were about to, you know, they were going to, you know, what do you call it, break ground, you know, put the first shovel in, we all said, that's it. This is going to be a disaster now because the government's involved.
Yeah, and so it was born.
And so it was born.
The disaster.
And that's all she wrote.
All right, now, moving on. Leave NBN in the ground where it's going to stay for the next 100 years.
Gillard, you're an idiot.
mobile phone operators, their license spectrum fee licenses are up. So... spectrum licenses necessary for delivering mobile services are up for renewal this year. And as the government puts the final touches to the renewal process, the expectation is the sale of the licenses could bring up to $4 billion into consolidated revenue. When the licenses were first sold to Telstra, Optus and Vodafone back in 1998 and 2000, they fetched a combined $2 billion. But as the use of mobile services has boomed and kaboomed and exterminated all everything else over the past decade, analysts expect... Oh, I knew I should have that shave. Analysts expect the fee to double. So,
And actually, I think it'll be more than that because they haven't mentioned anything about the sell-off of the spectrums that were reserved for this. Like, there are certain spectrums that they've been testing over the last few years to release to mobile providers to increase, broadband or mobile bandwidth for data and things like that. So it's entirely possible it could even be more than that if they add these other spectrums to it. So,
well, analysts are estimating that renewals could cost between $800 million and $1 billion. For a 4-year license.
Well, you know what? I think that with the renewals, okay, you charge pretty much what you like because you've got them by the short and curlies because they've already got the spectrum. But with the new spectrum or additional spectrum, they'll only sell what the market's willing to pay. Because they had some spectrum auctions in the United States just before Christmas, and they were trying to get, because they're in, hock up to their ears as well, just like this country. Yeah. And so the government's trying to raise money because they're setting these unreasonable prices. And no one bought any because all the phone companies said, there's no freaking way. Why am I going to pay that? I'll just have to make do and lower your prices or else it's the customer that's going to suffer and we're going to blame it on the government for trying to rip us off with $4 billion for one spectrum. Give me a break.
Are they not to know that every 5 years they have to pay this money and this should already be accounted for?
The renewal, fees they've factored into their pricing of their retail in their corporate plans. It's the new spectrum that they're going to go, you know what? I'm not going to buy that. That's just too expensive.
The threat is, or the problem, or the worry, or whatever you want to call it, is for these phone companies, is that if they just let it go, as say like Vodafone, you'd be thinking, geez, they've just tipped $500 million into their network, and are they going to tip another $800 million just to renew their license? Well, probably yes. But what happens is if they don't renew, then that spectrum goes up for public auction. So that one that doesn't get renewed is then up for public auction. So is Vodafone going to take the risk of letting it go, and possibly not being able to get any spectrum? Therefore, what close? Well, that's the.
Well, then someone will want to buy it. They'll try and get it cheaper. The government minimum that the government will pay for will sell it for would be what they would have got as a renewal fee.
But don't forget too, every carrier is different. Like you've got Telstra that's got, I think they've got 5 frequencies now.
I have no idea.
They've got
850, 1100 in the country.
600 now as well. 600, I think 850. Yeah, 1100, 2400 or something.
24 or 22 or something like that.
Yeah, so they've got 4 or 5. Just,
I tell you what, I'd like to get on some of that onto that 600 bloody spectrum.
That goes through
bloody fast.
It goes through walls.
That's what I mean. Speaking of going through walls, last week we went shopping after Christmas in town. I don't know if you know the Queen Victoria Building, Glenn.
Sydney. Yep.
Yeah. Right. There's parking space down there, and I kid you not, I got my Telstra. And we went down eight levels underground.
Right.
Five bars on the Telstra.
Yep.
So why are they better? Why are they so good?
They got a low frequency.
Low frequency. The lower the frequency, the better penetration through wall.
The low frequencies are slower waves, so for data they're no good, but for voice they're a much more robust frequency. So they'll penetrate through things a lot better.
Well, yeah, pretty much rocks.
Even when I used to be with 3 in the city, I'd drive around and just get between 2 buildings and lose signal. But now that I'm with Telstra, I can be anywhere. Theoretically, actually, it travels 60 Ks across the open water. So you can be 60 Ks offshore and still make a phone call.
Nice.
Well, just before Christmas, we were out in the boat too, and we were out probably, 4 or 5 Ks offshore.
Yeah.
5 bars.
That's all right, isn't it? That's good.
It'll travel to the curvature of the Earth or something, or further, because it bends.
28, that's 28 kilometres.
Yeah. I think it travels double. It travels double that distance because it bounces, so.
Yeah, it'll be double the horizon which is quite a long way.
Yeah, sweet. All right, we better move on. Will, you got Eric, you got any more? Because we got
I got heaps.
All right, well, quick, we'll go through them quick. If we can.
Quickly, here we go. Qantas, this snuck in before Christmas. I didn't see it. Qantas to trial in-flight internet on their planes, but it's only going to be available for business and first class. Idiots, get it moving. Right, next one.
Did you have a picture for that one?
No, no.
No.
Gotta be fast.
Well, you tell me right. You got a picture and I'll put it up.
I've got a picture, Steve Jobs. Unofficial Steve Jobs figure. So realistic, it's creepy.
Oh, it is creepy. I sent you that one too. It is creepy.
That's
Is that it? Is that the figure or is that it, the real him?
That's the figure. Look at his hands.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, right. Jeez. Crazy. Crazy stuff.
I was gonna say it's a good imitation of a Mac, isn't it?
Yeah. It is.
What's your next one?
Next one. Sony's $200 tablet S price gouge. We're paying $200 more than everyone else in the world for the Sony 16 gig model. So, bloody get your act together, Sony. Piss off.
That's it. Is that all you had?
That's it.
That's good. Good. What was that Optus story? Oh, you did that one. What was that one?
You did it with you.
Oh,
we did
okay.
It together.
Okay. Oh, you had a graphic? Oh, yeah, the same one. The Sony, same one. That was better than mine. All right. I'll put that one up. Show everyone. Seeing you went to the trouble to do it. Okay. Now, Will, you got some quick ones.
Yeah. Excuse me. You notice at the top of the show we're talking about PayPal. Well, on a related story, Yahoo has announced its new chief executive, naming PayPal's president, Scott Thompson, to become its new leader and board member.
Oh. He'll be fired in two weeks.
Good on him.
Because once again, the board has screwed it up by picking the wrong bloke.
Oh, you think? The guy who destroys violins for a living?
Just guessing.
According to a poll, 700 million users picked him. So,
is it you? The users pick him?
Yahoo went on a poll of users who would what how to pick a CEO.
Yeah.
Why don't you just have a raffle?
Is that the same?
It'd be more scientific.
Is that
the same? Funny part is when they announced it, their shares went down 2%.
No surprise, it's there.
Is that the same poll that's told Yahoo not to be bought out by Microsoft for like $1 squillion? And then
it's also the same board that fired Carol Burt's because she called the board doofuses.
Well, I think Bart was right.
She's probably right. Now, what's this one here? Will got a picture of some dude on an iPad. What's this one?
Ah, the digital passport. Okay, basically what happened was this Canadian man got to the US border and realized that he'd forgotten his passport and driver's license and things like that. Thankfully, just as something he felt like doing a few weeks earlier, he had actually just scanned them into his iPad. And Martin Riche said yesterday that he handed it to a slightly annoyed border officer and that he went to his little booth and made a couple of phone calls and come out 10 minutes later and said, you know,
that's
welcome
it?
To the country and Merry Christmas.
Wow. Question. Question.
Yes.
When you get to the other side, did he lose his passport? Oh, this might not be in the story. Did he lose his passport before he boarded the plane or while he was on the plane?
No, it's just a road trip across the border.
Right. Okay. So if he's going for a road trip across the border, wouldn't they have checked him at the exit?
That's where it was. That was the border
between
Canada.
So there's only one
Canada
point
and
in, one point out. Okay.
All right. And basically, you know, apparently they say that they don't accept facsimiles and copies, but I don't know. But as he says, hopefully that in the future we'll all just be, you know,
doing iPad photos
here effectively. So
right. Wouldn't want to run out of battery.
Don't. Now, what's this Mozilla Firefox thing?
Now, okay, if you show that screen grab there, you'll see that the entire Mozilla, the Mozilla Public License or the MPL, basically tells you what you can and can't do, what you're allowed to do with the file, what you're not allowed to do with it. They decided to update it. As you can see, they pretty much crossed everything out and basically shortened to, you may create and distribute a larger work, provided that you comply with the requirements of the license for the covered software. That's basically what it comes down to. So effectively, don't worry about all that crap that we've had lawyers pay millions of dollars to write up.
Yeah.
You're allowed to send, you're allowed to distribute it, provided you say it's us.
Right.
That's pretty much what it comes down to.
Hopeless. Hopeless.
And they're hoping that's going to become the standard for a lot of licenses now, because, as I say, people don't read the long ones, but you give them something short like that. Well, if you give them, what, four lines of text, there's a fair chance they're going to read it. So,
well, I didn't read my ISP terms and conditions with the five-day thing. And he's spewing. They should shorten that. Take that right out. Maybe I should go to Fair Trading or something. That's, I don't think that's not nice,
is it? Well,
you could
just, like, say it's your fault and deal with it.
Why would you need 5 days? Oh, they gave me some crap excuse. They said, oh, it takes 5 days to shut down. It's not a nuclear bloody power plant. Come on.
They've got to send somebody to the exchange and disconnect.
Just out of interest, Milo just asked, is Yahoo worth anything these days? And I just said, yes, $15 per share or $20 billion. And out of interest, Telstra is worth $42 billion. Apple is $413 billion. And Microsoft is $230 billion. So Apple is nearly worth twice Microsoft.
Wow.
Well, that's what they were saying. Apple could buy, just with their free cash, they could buy the U.S. debt.
Yeah.
They wouldn't. Make the U.S. debt free.
That'd be the worst investment they've ever made.
I realise that, but, you know, they're not really a company at this point. They're a,
they're know, a small
giant
nation.
Cash machine.
Behemoth.
They're a large nation.
Yeah.
Well, put it another way. Hang on a minute. The U.S. debt, no, they couldn't buy the U.S. debt. They'd buy a fair chunk of it. The U.S. debt is running at $1 trillion. I think they've got cash flow of, they've got, I think, $100 billion in the bank. So they've got 10% they could buy. But the scary thing is, they've got, the U.S. government has got $1 trillion in debt, but China has $2 trillion in their coffers.
Oh, yeah, that is
scary. That's
the scary part. 80% of it would be U.S. money. Oh, no, not 80%, half of it. Half of it.
Yeah.
Definitely half of it.
Well, $6.
So China could buy the U.S. right now.
$6.95 if it's mine, because I just bought something from them. All right. Now, someone else has gone to the wall, talking about going to the wall. Remember Kodak?
Yep.
They could be longer.
I mean, well, just to remind everybody, that Kodachrome picture that you're showing there, they stopped production of that 8 or 9 months ago now.
Yeah.
They stopped developing heaps of their products, you know, up to a couple of years ago. And I think the only thing they were really doing, you can still buy a camera, a digital camera. You can still buy a normal 35mm roll of film. And that's about it. And you can buy the old
disposable
point-and-shoots. Yeah. Yeah. They're like $4 each now.
So what's the story, Glenn, that if they don't sell their patents, they're going to go under?
Yeah, well, right? Eastman Kodak is preparing to file for bankruptcy in the coming weeks if efforts to sell off the digital patents fall through. Ooh, yes, I am. According to the Wall Street Journal. Now, Kodak is in talks with potential lenders for around $1 billion. Now, my question to probably Eric would be the best one. If you're in debt for $1 billion, who the hell is going to lend you money?
That's going to depend on whether or not if they are satisfied that your negotiations with the buyers of your potential patents are... they'll hedge. They'll take a chance if they feel that, okay, this is going well. You're going to sell some of these. You'll be able to lower the debt within, you know, and they'll have a time frame.
High interest.
And they'll have lots of, the interest will probably be higher than normal.
Mm.
They'll have lots of conditions attached before they give them 1 cent.
Yeah. Yeah. Kodak.
They'll pretty much secure, you know, if they've got land and buildings and assets, they basically take a complete charge over the whole company.
But how are they going to?
They will liquidate everything.
Mm.
You know, the physical assets to get their money back.
So that they're coming from the point of, well, we're not just going to keep trading just with $1 billion debt. We've got to actually, sell the stuff, reduce the debt.
That's right. It's going to be conditional on
reducing the
proving debt. To them that we're actually going to reduce the debt.
Yeah.
In the short to the medium term.
Yep.
And for the people that don't know, Eastman Kodak, Paul McCartney's ex-wife, Linda Eastman, is a direct descendant to the Eastman Kodak family.
Is that one leg?
His wife that died of cancer.
Oh, the other one.
Yes, his first wife.
She's not a director anymore.
No, she's a descendant.
Descendant.
Her family is Eastman. Her name was Linda Eastman.
Oh, I see. Right. I didn't know.
So she's a direct descendant to the Eastman Kodak company, and she still has or her family has still quite a lot of money tied up in that company.
That they'll never see.
Well, whatever's left, yes.
The 131-year-old company is, 131 is making last-ditch efforts to sell around 1,100 patents. Oh, my God. Under a court-supervised auction. Some of those
the box brownie.
Yeah, probably.
That's right. That's my next question is that your patents are probably, well, hello.
Yeah, that's right.
Even their new ones are old. You know, like, when was the last, other than a handful of digital cameras they've bought out, when was the last time they did anything big?
They haven't done anything for a very long time.
Yeah. Yep,
early 80s?
And probably a prime example of if they're not going to innovate, well, you die. Kodak once sold 90% of the world's film, but started to struggle in the 1980s as foreign competitors gained market share. Kodak shares plunged 28% on the report. Now, I did have another question about that, Eric, but you've answered it with my first question. My other question was, why'd they only plunge 28% if they're going to go bankrupt? But they're going to reduce the debt.
The market's factoring in that's probably all they're worth.
Yep. And last quick story from me, hopefully quick. It will be, don't you worry, is Windows 7 gains as XP is once again on the decline. So XP is slowly moving out of favour, and so it should, because it's old and clunky and no one should be using it anymore.
10-year-old.
If you're using it.
I have a retraction. Linda Eastman is not related to Eastman Kodak.
Oh.
I was given incorrect information.
Oh, no.
Here's the Wikipedia article. So retract. Not like the Labor government, who'll never admit they're wrong. I retract that statement.
All right, good retraction. Luckily, we didn't have to come back next week to retract it.
When you say Windows XP is down, you're talking 1.5 or 2%
That's going down. It's on the decline. So okay, the whole thing goes, Windows XP accounted for 46.5% of all desktop operating systems in use worldwide in December, which was down from 48.9% in November. So it's lost 3%. But it's continuing to lose the same percentages each month, roundabout. Windows 7 is 37% of all desktop and laptop computers, and that's up from 34.6. So you could probably see, what's that, 37, 34, 3, 46. So it's, say, about XP's going down 3, and Windows is going up 3. So that probably makes sense to me. Windows overall Windows across all the desktops continues to dominate, running on almost 92% of all desktop and laptop computers. And Mac OS accounts for 5%, and Linux and others making up the rest.
Apparently, maths was hard. They couldn't figure it out.
No, that's just the rest.
3% for those playing along at home.
Yeah. That's right. Will's good at maths. All right.
But, that's interesting. But what's that say for Windows 8 when Windows, or whatever they're going to call it, Windows 8 comes out? Is that going to be 2020 before it gains popularity?
Oh, I don't know. XP gained popularity pretty much overnight. But I think they're just saying that.
That's because it was replacing a piece of crap.
Yeah. Well, Windows 7 is.
I think Vista is their turning point. Because Vista existed, it stopped people from looking at 7.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Because Vista was... Look, I had no issue really.
Well,
with
every
Vista.
Second operating system that they produce is crappy, if you work backwards and think about it. So Windows 8 is bound to be the next crappy one, because Windows 7 is a dream.
It's going to sell well in China.
What, Windows
8? For $3.
Oh, well, you're right, for the number.
Yeah.
Number 8.
Yeah, that's right.
I'll get three copies and only pay for one.
That's
it. Eight copies for 88 cents.
eight copies for every burnt disc. Okay. All right. Well, that's about the end of the show. Woo! So it's we went over time, but anyway, that doesn't matter because it's been great. Great to have you back, Will.
Have me on, won't it?
That's right. That's been good.
Yeah, shut up, Will.
Now you can contact Will, Eric, or myself at Glenn Eric with a K, Eric, E-R-I-K, Glenn, Eric, or Will at AussieTechHeads.com.au. You can get Will on his Twitter at Mr. Tomkinson, me at AussieTechHeads, yep. and Eric at Eric with a K, Franco, F-R-A-N-C-O. And what else is there? That's about it.
And I do need to plug the return of Talkback Tech and maybe the Android show if I can get another couple of hosts. We will be recording again. He's Frosty. I will be having back with me this week, but he's doing shift work, so I can't have him.
He
can't
was busy
have Frosty
during Christmas.
he was
busy. Frosty the Snowman was busy during Christmas.
That's it.
He's melted.
So watch. live.thesacredhub.com Tuesdays from about 6:30ish Australian Eastern Standard Time. And you can also listen to the audio only feed at talkbacktech.com or and Shoutcast.
Is that why Frosty lives in Tasmania? He can't live anywhere else. He's good.
They won't let him out.
Melt. That's because he works in a cheese fridge all day.
And does he really?
Yeah, that's what he does. He's a cheese maker or something.
And of course, Eric chewing the fat is back.
Barring any dramas with the audio,
touch wood,
baby.
Yeah, chewing the fat on iTunes, on the YouTube, and get it any way you can. Doesn't matter how you get it, you just get it. And
torrent me, baby.
Oh, torrent me off. Oh, and you can do that. Or you can watch Chewing the Fat live record if all goes according to plan at live.thesecrethub.com after Aussie Tech Heads, which is right now. So until next week, bye Eric, bye Will, and bye Lounge, and we'll see you all next week. Bye-bye.